for still being here. So I just wanted to orient everybody a little bit about what I mean by the safety net here, just as a reminder. So I'm sure everybody knows the California name for many of these programs, but just to get so that we're all starting on the same page. We have a very fragmented safety net in the U.S. We have many different programs with many different eligibility rules and many different cliffs at which people lose their eligibility. So I'm going to talk about some of these and not all these programs, but just to give you a taste. TANF, that's the replacement to cash welfare for families with children. AFDC, it used to be called. Food stamps, which is CalFresh, is vouchers, or now EBT cards for unprepared food. The earned income tax credit, many people wouldn't call that part of the safety net, but it really functions as such, and that is a federal tax credit. Unemployment compensation, again, not everybody would include that, but we saw UI be extended to unprecedented lengths in the Great Recession, and it was fully federally funded, those expansions, okay? There are disability benefits, medical care for families with kids is mostly Medicaid and CHIP, and then there's a bunch of other programs that I won't talk about so much. Just to give you this sense, most of these programs are means tested and categorical, so you have to be part of a particular group. Cash welfare, you had to be part of, you had to have kids under 18 in your family. Some of the other programs are social insurance programs where you also have to pay a premium for a while, but mostly that's not what I'm going to talk about. Okay. And then just to give you a sense of where the money is, so these are some numbers from 2010. There were about 35 million families with a kid. Medicaid for non-disabled children was 27 million children and $82 billion. So now you can see why that is an attractive thing to think about slashing if you need money to pay for something. That's why Medicaid is part of the discussion, because it's so much money and it's an enormous share of state budgets. TANF, the replacement to the cash welfare program, is tiny now. It's $11 billion, and it's 1.9 million families. That was in 2010. Food stamps, pretty big program. 19 million families, $65 billion. So again, you can see why that's an attractive thing to take money away from if you're trying to save some money to spend on the military or other things. The earned income tax credit is massive, so $60 billion in 2010 and many, many families. And then these other programs, are not as big, even though there are a lot more money for the people that get them, okay? So I'm going to briefly touch on some new evidence, or relatively new evidence, about how the safety net is helping children. So the first bits of evidence are going to be how the Great Recession tested our new safety net after we had gotten rid of cash welfare as an entitlement program and turned it into the kind of block grant that there are discussions about making other programs become now. I'm going to touch on some research about the long-run effects of war on poverty programs that Ross also touched on in a little bit more detail. We have new exciting administrative data sets and field experiments, and then I'm going to also maybe touch on some things Ross already said about behavioral science, okay? So we're like the twofer. If we repeat enough times, it's like any professor, you've got to repeat it more than once. All right, so we had enormous changes in our welfare system in the 1990s. We went from a system where you didn't work, where the tax rate on working was 100% in cash welfare after a while, to an in-work system for aid to families with children, okay? So we all expanded the EITC greatly when we shrunk AFDC and turned it into a block grant. And so then the Great Recession hits, and what happens? So what... In some work with my co-author Hillary Hoynes, we found is that TANF does not respond anymore, okay? So this is just one way of graphically showing you the response of two different programs to the changes in unemployment rate over the Great Recession. So along the x-axis is the percentage point change in the state's unemployment rate, and on the y-axis is the percent change in the caseload per capita. So here, this is SNAP, so you can all see that it's upward sloped. So the bigger the change in the unemployment rate over the Great Recession, the bigger the responsiveness of the SNAP program, okay? That's how you want an entitlement safety net program to work. You know, more people become eligible, more money gets spent, okay? So it provides some benefit to the government beyond, you know, stopping people from starving, which is the goal of SNAP. It also provides some benefit in that you put some more money into those people's hands, they spend money, and it has some spill-on effects. This is TANF, okay? So this is our new, this is the new block granted program, and you can see there is zero relationship there. There's no relationship between a state having a bigger increase in the unemployment rate and having an increase in their TANF participation, okay? And that's not just because this is the unemployment rate for everybody. If you did the unemployment rate for families with kids, it would look the same. So that was not true in previous recessions. While TANF has never been a gigantic program because eligibility levels, thresholds are quite low, it did used to be a countercyclical program, okay? So then you might think, well, now we have the EITC, this tax credit, which we greatly expanded between 1993 and 1996. Has this replaced TANF as a stabilizer? In some other work with Hillary and also a former graduate student from Villarica, we find no. Okay, so the EITC in a level way, sort of at a point in time, the EITC does, if you took away people's EITC income, more people would be in poverty. But it is not behaving in a countercyclical way, and that makes sense because of the way the program is constructed. You have to work to get the program, so if a lot of people get kicked out of work, they're not going to be getting the EITC anymore. Now, you could imagine many people from higher up the income distribution would fall into the eligibility range for the EITC, but those tend to be more higher skilled people, married families, than people who are at the bottom who are getting kicked out of the system. Those are single parent families, low skill families, okay? So in terms of stabilization, this is sort of the opposite of the way AFDC used to operate, okay? Why, might you ask, is TANF doing this? Well, TANF is really more like a funding stream. That's not entirely true in the state of California, which seems to continue to spend more money on cash assistance than almost all other states, but this shows nationally where states are spending their TANF money, okay? So this little chunk here called basic assistance, that's what used to be cash welfare. That used to be about two-thirds of the spending. This is child care, this pretty big bunch here, and this is work-related stuff. So half the money that goes for this program is going for things that you could think of as being loosely tied to what the program used to be, okay? So what's the other half going to? Other things that the state wants to spend money on that further the goals of TANF to prevent out-of-wedlock pregnancy and promote two-parent families, okay? So some is going to social services block grants, some is going to state EITCs, which are targeted at people higher up the income distribution and would have been eligible for the program, and what might be a surprisingly large share, 9% in this year, is going to non-marital pregnancy prevention and two-parent family formation. And in the process of writing this Hamilton brief with Hillary Hoynes, you know, I discovered this interesting thing that in Oklahoma, something like 10% of the population has had some sort of, you know, marriage or pregnancy class that's funded by their TANF grant, okay? You know, so the message there is, you know, if states don't want to have a cash assistance program and then you give them a block grant, even with a lot of maintenance of effort, it's really hard to get them to not steal that money for other purposes, okay? And in the Great Recession, you know, I'm sort of studying things from on high from this academic perspective, but the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities is much more close to the ground, and they sort of describe the response varying across places as to whether the state had TANF as something that could be ramped up quickly when times were bad or not. So Florida was a state where they actually had it in such a way that when things got worse, they could spend more money on it easily. But other states, so Illinois and Texas are two very low share states. They spend about 7 or 8% on cash assistance. It's not in a way that they can ramp it up when times are bad. Okay, so this is one sort of challenge that's associated with moving to a block grant world. The second bits of evidence that I'm going to talk about are short and long run effects of war on poverty programs. So because the war on poverty is 50 years old, people are now old, and we can look at what happens when you're older. I shouldn't say old because I'm the same age as the people in these papers, but older, we can find the long run effects of these programs on those people. Okay, so there have been papers looking at effects in adulthood of food stamps, Medicaid, Medicare, Head Start, WIC, and others, and I would say the bulk of these find long-run positive effects on health, self-sufficiency, and education. And I'm just going to touch on two different programs that are the ones that are sort of most where the money is if you want to steal some money for other things from current entitlement spending. Okay? So in a series of papers, this group of authors, including my co-author Hillary Hoynes, have looked at how the food stamp program rolled out idiosyncratically across counties in the US. So this chart shows you the time of adoption of the food stamp program in different counties. Okay? And so then they can look before and after within each county at, you know, if you were born before or after, essentially, are your outcomes different later on, while using as a control group all the other places that didn't change at the same time. Okay, so you can look at this and you can see, well, yeah, sure, it looks like Nevada did everywhere at the same time, but there's a lot of variation across locations. It's not all one part of the country. It's not all rural or urban areas. And so, you know, this gives you a good design for looking at the effects of this program. This chart is taken from a paper of theirs, and you can't see it very well, so I'm just going to tell you what it says. But this outcome here is metabolic syndrome, which is an index of things about your weight, you know, do you have diabetes, other bad outcomes, sort of averaged together, because they're using a small panel data set to look at this, and they find out that, you know, the more of food stamps you're exposed to from ages 0 to 5, the better this index is for you, okay, and it's a pretty big effect for the people that are most likely to be targeted by the program, okay. They also find an effect on self-sufficiency, but they can't tell the difference between, they can't reject that it's zero in this particular data set, but they do find a positive, I mean, the coefficients are good, okay? In some work of mine with a student, former student who's at the Treasury Department, we actually find that at age 32 for women, if you were exposed to food stamps in your county from 0 to 5, your income is about 2% larger, and it's statistically significant, okay? So I think the reason for them not to find it in this data set is just that it's a small effect. Medicaid, another program, has been shown to have lots of short and long run positive effects, so I'm just touching on subsets of this literature. There are positive effects on infant mortality of both the expansions in the late 80s and early 1990s and the rollout of Medicaid in the 60s. There are positive effects on obesity of the 80s and 90s expansion. Marianne has some work showing that even for the next generation, so if you as a child were exposed to the expansions of the 80s and 90s, your babies are healthier later on, so there's this sort of two-generation, intergenerational positive effect. And using one of these enormous new tax data sets where they have the panel of everybody in the whole U.S., they can show that there are higher earnings for people who were exposed to more of this expansion, okay? So, you know, this is not a full cost benefit by any stretch of the imagination, but this is definitely showing some benefits of these programs. The third source of information comes from these large administrative data sets and from some experiments. So Raj Chetty is in the newspaper almost weekly, it feels like, with new fascinating information from this gigantic tax data set where they've linked the entire panel of all tax filings for everybody since 1996, I think. And they have kids going further back, and there are a number of experiments and quasi-experiments. The sort of research you can do with this is an example from the SSI program, is if you have administrative data on who's on the program, there was something about the way that welfare reform was implemented that meant that at age 18, more people were going to be re-examined to see if they should get kicked off the program, and a lot more of them got kicked off the program, okay? And, you know, again, the thing to take away is if you get kicked off the program, you earn less later on. You earn more later on, but not enough to make up for the lost benefits, okay? So there was definitely, you know, people do work more if you kick them off SSI, but, you know, compared to people like them, they don't earn as much as the lost income that they have, okay? And finally, we have, you know, these insights from behavioral science that economists have been slow to absorb, suggesting that the neoclassical model might not perfectly predict people's behavior, okay? And this increasing interest in sort of using these things about behavioral science, nudges, et cetera, to try to change people's behavior. And then the context of thinking about these programs is important for understanding take-up. Okay, so take-up is how many people who are potentially eligible for a program actually use it. And, you know, economists have these ideas, so there's stigma, which we think is important for a lot of programs. Some people are embarrassed to use them. That came up in the context of the school meals programs, and there are informational questions, okay? But there haven't been very good designs for thinking through this, and so one of the papers that's really interesting uses an experiment for people who didn't claim the ITC but were eligible. They convinced the IRS to run an experiment and try a bunch of different things. So it turns out, you know, people who are getting the ITC may know sort of where they, you know, should most ideally locate to get the most benefits, but they don't really understand the program fully. So they tried this whole host of different things that are looped, like can be put in three categories. One is complexity. Is the complexity of the program part of the problem? Yes, because things that are different from this line mean statistically significant effects. Okay, did program information matter? Yes, it mattered. And then did stigma matter? Not as much as they would have expected given the previous research, okay? So I think all of these things are relevant for thinking about the current context, and then I'm gonna jump into some possible solutions before my discussant comes up and tells us more useful stuff about California and whether or not these are crazy. So the first thing is this sort of pie in the sky view, which is, why don't we just get rid of this patchwork safety net altogether and just pay kids, pay families with kids? We already sort of do this for people who pay taxes. You know, you get an exemption for your kids. There's a child tax credit and there's the ITC. Marianne and I have a Russell Sage proposal with Annie Hines, who's here in the audience. We could finance about $2,000 a kid purely by repurposing some of these tax credits we already have. And it could go to all kids, not just kids who pay taxes, and it would be something, it would be a commitment from our country that we care about kids, okay? Obviously, that's a little unrealistic right now, but, you know, why not talk about what you could have? Something second that could probably potentially be done at the state level is we have this new state level California EITC, but it is not guaranteed. Funding for it is not guaranteed, it's year to year. That is something that could be done, could be made permanent and fully funded. And then finally, maybe, you know, options for to provide consumption smoothing could use multiple years of earnings. That's another thing that could be done within the current system without that much of a change, okay? Something I'm very interested to hear what people who know more about things on the ground think is, what are the possibilities if federal block grants ensue for some of these programs, or if programs are cut for filling in with state funding? And then I would just make a plea, because I think it's really important to push to enhance data access to these big data sets. So there's a team at UCLA and Berkeley and also one at Stanford that's trying to link together a bunch of different administrative data systems for the state. But you know, more access to data can only be better. And then finally, put in a plug for experiments because we learned a lot of stuff we didn't know otherwise. Okay?
Thank you.
We're going to sit down. You might think we're copying the people in front of us, but we actually had the idea first. No, just kidding. So my name is Jessica Bartholow. I'm with the Western Center on Law and Poverty, and I work here at the Capitol on many of the programs that you heard Professor Rittler talk about today, the safety net programs. First I'd like to start off by just saying, you know, we really appreciate the UC Davis Poverty Research Center, the research that comes out of it, the thinking, sometimes even the testimony. Professor Thompson actually testified a couple years ago on a policy proposal that we finally won this past year, which I'll talk about in a minute. But it's an incredible resource to have right here in California, and we do use the research. So I love the fact that we're here today talking about what is, you know, the next set of research that we could use to help us drive forward, both kind of in a time of uncertainty nationally, but also at a time where we certainly have the ear of policymakers here in California. Now more than ever, we know that our policy leaders, both of them who've experienced poverty in their own communities and in their own families and sometimes very personally, leading our Senate and our Assembly and many of our chair people in our important committees having, again, a real strong vocal commitment to ending poverty, reducing poverty, making sure that families and children and our elderly and disabled people who are experiencing poverty are not suffering from the harm and pain of not having health insurance, are not just sent into a lifelong spiral of poverty simply because they had the bad luck of being born poor or into a community that's poor. So with that, responding to the presentation that you just saw, I want to speak first about the block granting. You heard the focus be on block granting, and I know that was the last kind of policy proposal on the list, but I'm going to start there. And the reason is because the research that you saw today showing that TANF block grant does not respond to recession. It also doesn't, it wasn't up here on the presentation, but it also doesn't respond to disaster, a disaster response as well. This has led to great hardship for not just for TANF recipients across the country, but here in California too. Even as you saw that we were able to retain a significant portion of our TANF benefits for low-income people, we still have kept a number of those benefits away from TANF recipients, so much so that at one point we had a benefit level that was 39%, a maximum benefit level that was 39% of the federal poverty line. And that's to account for that many people who receive a Cal grant or a CalWORKs grant or a TANF grant not everybody in the household was counted. So many more households were down below that, below 39% of the federal poverty line. Well, why do I talk about that statistic? Because according to researchers who study the brains of children and the well-being of children, 50% of the federal poverty line is a very dangerous place to be. You're more likely to go to the hospital. You're more likely to die. You're more likely to not be able to graduate from high school, not go to college, and not be able to have the important brain function and development that's needed for successful life outcomes, healthy life outcomes. You're less likely to be able to avoid depression and mental health disorders. At one point, when we were studying a policy that would increase the benefit level up to at least above 50% of the poverty line, we reached out to researchers and I said, so could you tell me the difference, like what's the difference between 39% of the federal poverty line for a child and 50? And I looked everywhere. We contacted you, we contacted other poverty centers throughout the country, and nobody had that research. And finally I asked somebody, well, why don't you have the research? And they said, because the outcome of below 50% of the poverty line is so dire that it doesn't make sense to study less than that. So how many kids on TANF are below 50% of the federal poverty line in the country? All of them. All of them. How many children were protected from 50% of the federal poverty line, or called deep poverty or extreme poverty, before welfare reform, before we block granted our TANF program? None of them. All of them were protected from it. None of them were in deep poverty. Here in California, under Governor Pete Wilson, under Governor Reagan, we had an AFDC program that kept these families at 71% of the federal poverty line. At one point, even closer to 100% of the federal poverty line. The implementation of TANF and of welfare reform, block granting this program, absolutely contributed to children living in dire situations, experiencing the pain and hardship of deep poverty, hunger, homelessness, etc. You heard earlier in the panels about the impacts of children going to school and arriving to school with the long detriment of childhood poverty behind them, and what that does to their academic circumstances. We are talking about kids who are suffering. So, here in California, what did that look like? I told you a little bit about the incomes. The other thing that happened is, during the recession, not only were we able to respond appropriately, which is expansive, but we actually had to cut back the program. We moved the program from 60 months of eligibility, which is allowed under federal law, to 48 months of eligibility for the adults. We then further cut that without any evidence that would contribute to improved work outcomes. We cut that further to 24 months of eligibility for welfare to work services, except for in certain circumstances. Those setbacks remain. We have legislation, AB 160, authored by Assemblymember Stone, that would restore that. We believe that that's an appropriate measure. Did we respond in California by cutting back some of the programs, and we had to because we were in a budget recess, a significant budget crisis. But we also weren't able to put a pause on some of the work requirements and time limits. The appropriate response during the recession, the worst recession of our lifetime, a recession that left so many people unemployed, even if they had higher ed degrees, even if they had a full lifetime of employment history, the appropriate response for out-of-work adults with children during that time period would have been to stop the time limits, just pause them, end the work requirements, and instead we required people to go to welfare to work services. In order for an adult to receive aid during the worst recession of our lifetime, they had to participate in welfare to work. And what did that mean? For too many people, what it meant was they went into an office, they went through the phone book, and they made phone calls. asking for jobs that they knew didn't exist, that their caseworkers knew didn't exist, that people across the building knew that it didn't exist, that DC knew didn't exist. We all allowed them, required them to do that in order to get what? $130 a month. Why did they do it? Because they would be homeless without it. This is the kind of very stupid policy making that we're doing when we block grant programs. And we're about to do it again unless we are able to articulate why this is a bad decision. Not only did that hurt the families, it also harmed the economy, right? When poor people don't have money, it doesn't mean that they're not able to put money in their savings account. It doesn't mean that they're not able to put money in the stocks. They're not, they're not keeping their money instead from their Cayman Island accounts, or now it's Panama accounts, I can't remember, can't keep track. They're not spending it in their own communities. They're not able to pay their rent. The landlord suffers. The bodega, the corner store suffers. And the people who work there then suffer. So this is why it's very important for us to be articulate about not block granting the SNAP program, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. You saw that program expanded. We saw here in California, when people needed that program, they were able to apply for it and get it. And what did that mean? That meant dollars that they were able to spend in the community, and that kept jobs in the community, and in turn slowed down the recessionary effects of the economy going sour. For SNAP, every $1 billion that is spent in the community for SNAP, it creates anywhere between about 7,000 and 14,000 jobs, depending on whether or not your economy depends on agriculture. So for here in California, it's nearly 14,000 jobs that we're creating every time $1 billion in SNAP is received by a family who needs it to prevent hunger. And the same we would say about Medicaid, right? You saw the evidence here in Professor Bittler's presentation, the relationship between Medicaid and access to health care and improved employment outcomes. Well, yeah. You know, when you don't have a tooth dying in your mouth and that prevents you from being able to go to work and face the public, people who work in low-income jobs are forced always to be facing the public to talk to them about, to make them feel welcome and sell them something good. And when you are sick, when you hurt, when you're in pain, when you have unmet medical needs, you're less likely to be able to do that. And so you saw better outcomes for Medicaid if families receive it in work for this generation and next generations. So as we move forward in the next couple of years into the policy dialogue before us, the table that's being set for us in DC, we're going to be able to use this partnership with researchers and practitioners of policy and recipients of the policies that we make to explain why investments in these programs are about creating jobs, why investments in these programs, not in a block grant format, are about creating an America where everybody has access to the American dream. So we really do need the research to be able to do that, and really appreciate this conversation, this dialogue, and I look forward to the questions. Thanks.
Thank you.
We'll take questions. Yes?
I have a question about this wacky idea that we could address the problem of large numbers of families not having enough financial resources by providing them with financial resources. as Ross's talk showed, we're continually learning more and more about the multitude of pathways through which poverty shapes kids' lives. And as we learn more, it just multiplies the number of possible downstream areas that we could intervene on. And that's sort of our approach, it seems like. So at some point, why isn't it the case that if the inefficiencies and costs associated with a sort of scattershot or patchwork approach to intervening on poverty become sort of unsustainable and makes a more basic upstream approach toward addressing poverty more politically feasible, especially if we could achieve it by not directing more money, just sort of reallocating money more straightforward, efficient way.
So the question is, what about the proposal that we just that we try to offer everybody a kind of a base income, right, or a base level of sustainability for a family? the one critique of that that I know of is when we try to take ideas and turn them into policy, we're asked to prioritize, right? This would be a significant policy and financial investment to do something like this. So perhaps a step towards that would be to simply raise the income of the safety net so that it is above 50% of the federal poverty line, or so that no child is living in poverty. There's at least a safety net program that captures everybody before they fall into poverty with a child. So that would be one proposal to get there very quickly. You wouldn't have to change any structure. You just fund the program to where it keeps children out of poverty. And sure, people who participate in the program would have certain rules to adhere to it, but it would make it possibly make it more easy to find commitment towards because of those rules. The other alternative is something like a universal basic income, which has been discussed and continues to be explored here in California. And I actually think that we should be thinking about something like that. We should say to our children and to our generations, it's not appropriate that they live without their basic needs. I don't know what you would add to that.
Well, I mean, it's pretty politically feasible. And the reason we propose this thing through the tax system, because it wouldn't cost any more to be scored separately, right? The tax stuff gets scored separately. There's hordes of people in Congress who've sworn to never raise taxes ever, right? Some of them don't like tax credits either, but at least if it's got the name taxes on it, it's treated differently. But I would just say, this paid for about between $1,900 or $2,000 a kid. That's what it would pay for. That's not going to take you to the poverty level.
So in the spirit of looking at state solutions with the challenges federally, you mentioned it's right up there, currently on the state-level EITC.
Yeah.
Is there any hope for upping the income limits on the Cal EITC at this point?
Yeah, so California just established our first state EITC. We're really proud of that. And it's to a pretty big range of people who are working. It excludes self-employed individuals. We're the only state to do that. I'm not sure why we did that. My own mother benefited from EITC as a self-employed person. She used those taxes to pay for her SSI, her self-employment taxes, which she needed to use later so that when she got terminal cancer at a very young age, she was able to receive the services through Medi-Cal and through Social Security as she died, as most people do when they live their adult life in poverty at a very young age. This is, there's no reason to limit EITC for self-employed individuals, and we absolutely have to start there. The other thing that we could be doing, though, is expanding the amount that we give to people. We could do that very simply and still stay in line with the federal tax structure. And there are actually proposals to do that. The final proposal that has already been introduced is to think about expanding it to childless adults or to adults who have children that don't live with them, that this would be another place where we could expand the federal government. There are proposals to do that as well. I'm not sure whether or not California's proposal would take that route without the federal expansion, but I would hope we would consider it. And to make it permanent, the point about making it permanent is that the structure of our EITC is that we every year have to approve it, which actually I think keeps people from mobilizing and programatizing around the state EITC in the way that we could, which would increase uptake. I wanted to, because I mentioned it, the one place where we've been able to use some research in the state is this research around what does income do to low-income families? Like, how much does it help low-income families in the TANF programs? So this research was used to help us eliminate a policy that had been in place here in California called the TANF family cap, or referred to in California as the maximum family cap. A grant. It denied aid to children who were conceived and born into TANF simply because their parents were receiving aid at the time. This campaign took us 4 years. The research that really helped us were two pieces. One, many, 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 many types of research that showed that if you deny aid to a child, it actually doesn't keep their parents while they're conceiving the child from conceiving them. And it also doesn't impact the birth rate of low-income families. And so that research was really important. But it also wouldn't have worked by itself. On the other side, we had to show that an increase in aid actually helped families. At one point, we were talking with a very high-up budget official who said, why should we invest, why should we do this? These kids will still be in deep poverty. We won't get any credit for them. Meaning that our poverty rate won't increase, and you as poverty advocates will still come around here and bug us about it, right? So we needed that research. It was only one or two studies. They were kind of old, but they were really important for us to say, actually, these investments will help. They'll help some families be able to escape the long-lasting impact of childhood deep poverty. So those were really two really important research studies. One piece of research that we're really leaning on now is research that shows, for example, in our TANF program, we sanction a parent if they don't give an immunization to their kids. This based on the idea that if parents are bad, they won't immunize their kids, and if they do that, we can punish them financially, and they'll change their minds. Come to find out, the research that shows, there's a great book called Immunization, it's about this thick, that there's two types of people that don't immunize their kids. One are kind of middle class and wealthy white families who decide to do it based on their personal beliefs about the immunizations, and the others are desperately poor families of color who don't have access to healthcare, don't know how to work within the healthcare system, and that what they really want to do is immunize their kids. Punishing them with less money doesn't help them to do that or to overcome the barriers identified by this this social researcher. This type of research is so important to us. We're going to be able to repeal the sanction and instead offer people support, bus passes, access to immunization clinics, and instead of a slap on the hand and a push out the door. So really, again, thank you to researchers who I'll never meet. I'm really thankful to be in the room with them today, many of them today. But continue to do your work. Continue to reach out to us and real people experiencing real issues to find out what you're researching.